Hey everyone, I'm Jensen. Thanks for sticking with me for some afternoon-ish tea. I've got a lot of stories to cover today before we dive into our main story this afternoon. But before we do any of that, I want to show you what I'm munching on.
So if you missed it on Monday, I'm still working my way through these awesome no-bake cookies I made with the random ingredients in my cupboard. Super chocolatey and delicious.
And this is the crushed espresso from Rust Belt Coffee downtown. And I really need that extra kick today because there is a lot to get through today. So without wasting any more time, let's dive in.
Ohio Governor Mike DeWine bit the bullet and issued a mask order for the entire state on Wednesday. This officially goes into effect Thursday at 6 p.m., but the rules are nothing new for some of us. Here's when you need to wear a mask. In any indoor setting that's not a residence, when you're outside and unable to keep 6 feet away from people who don't live with you, and while waiting for or riding slash driving in any shared transportation like a bus, an Uber, or while hitching a ride in a 99 Dodge Neon, especially when hitching a ride in a 99 Dodge Neon.
But as always, there are a number of exemptions.
Here's when you don't have to wear a mask. If you're a child under 10, if you're someone who has a medical condition or disability that makes it unsafe to wear a mask, if you're communicating with someone who relies on lip reading while you're actively exercising or playing sports, if you're someone who officiates at religious services, anyone who's actively involved in public safety, and those who are actively eating or drinking because, well, obviously.
DeWine moved his presser to today after having to postpone it yesterday because, get this, another public official is facing federal bribery charges. Ugh, how embarrassing. This is just getting repetitive now.
On Tuesday, Ohio Speaker of the House Larry Householder and four others were accused in what could be, as one U.S. attorney put it, the largest bribery case ever in Ohio. Shoot for the moon, I guess. So what exactly are they all accused of? Well, the 80-page complaint claims that Householder and his cronies received more than $60 million to get him his job, pass House Bill 6, a bailout for First Energy-owned Davis-Besse and Perry nuclear power plants, and to make sure they don't let that bill get repealed. That money was coming from what attorneys are referring to as Company A, which was identified as a nuclear power company, I wonder who that could be, and given to Generation Now, a political operative group and somehow not a group of overzealous teen pop stars. But in reference to Generation Now, a U.S. attorney said,
"Make no mistake, this is Larry Householder's 501c4, as alleged in the charges."
But what exactly is the story behind House Bill 6? Through House Bill 6, the plants were getting a $1 billion bailout, and the bill was slowly dialing back on requirements for utilities to generate power from solar and wind, with the goal of eventually getting rid of those requirements entirely. And the House Dems aren't wasting any time and are already working on legislation that would repeal the controversial bill.
Although Governor Mike DeWine did say today that he would not support a repeal of that legislation.
And I could go on and on and on about this, but we have some more fish to fry a little bit closer to home because we've got some trouble in Toledo with a capital T and that rhymes with B and that stands for bribe. Please tell me I'm not the only one who does community theater. But yes, this seems to be the extortion episode of Afternoon Tea as we now dive deep into the Toledo City Council bribes for votes scandal. In case you missed it, four Toledo City Council members, Tyrone Riley, Yvonne Harper, Gary Johnson, and Larry Sykes, as well as local attorney Keith Mitchell, were arrested for allegedly taking bribes from local businesses for their votes on council, namely a lot of internet cafes.
But what the heck is an internet cafe, and what do they have to do with anything?
Internet cafes allow customers to log onto a computer to play games like slots for much smaller stakes. The state of Ohio actually banned these businesses in 2013, but a bunch of loopholes allowed them to keep on keeping on. In 2018, a number of council members were getting worried about the number of internet cafes that seemed to be operating illegally in Toledo, because at the time, only a handful out of like 15 or so had a license. So Tyrone Riley came up with an idea. Let these illegally operating businesses operate legally by letting them apply for a special use permit. And here's where things seem to get a little juicy.
The lawsuit claims that the accused council members started receiving bribes from these internet cafes to vote to approve their permits, before then bribing them yet again to issue a moratorium on new internet cafes so they could soak in all the business without more competition.
You know, it's like when you put together a lemonade stand and instead of providing a better quality product, you pay off the neighborhood bully to go Hulk smash Kelly's across the street because darn it, you want a puppy and your mom said you had to pay for it. We've all been there, right?
The case seems to be moving along swiftly as all four council members and the local attorney have been indicted by a grand jury, but the charges look a tad bit different. Because let's make things more confusing, right? Let's break down the indictment. First, the council members.
Tyrone Riley, 1 count of conspiracy and 5 counts of extortion. Yvonne Harper, 1 count of conspiracy, 2 counts of extortion, and 1 count of conspiracy to commit extortion. Gary Johnson, 1 count of conspiracy and 2 counts of extortion. Larry Sykes, 1 count of conspiracy and 2 counts of extortion. And attorney Keith Mitchell, 1 count of conspiracy and 2 counts of extortion. And today, 3 out of the 4 city council members were voluntarily suspended from their positions after repeatedly ignoring calls for their resignation from Mayor Wade and City Council President Matt Cherry, with only Gary Johnson left to sign on the dotted line. But with 3 city council members out of the mix, what happens next? Well, those seats need to be filled, at least temporarily. The probate judge, Jack R. Puffenberger, is now in charge of filling the suspended seats. People who are interested in temporarily filling those seats have until the 31st to send a resume to his email. But it's important to note that these are not replacements. People will only fill these seats until council members resign, are found innocent or are convicted, or there's an election. But that's all I have for you today. If you have more questions on anything we talked about, I have a link to more information in the description of this video, including the recipe for my weird cabinet cookies in case you missed that on Monday. And if you enjoyed this and you want to keep on sipping tea with me, hit that like button and hit subscribe. You know what you're supposed to do. And with all of that being said, I hope you get out there, make informed decisions, and I'll see you next time.